Well, good morning. My name is Greg Leonberger. I am the Director of Research here at Marquette. And I am here to discuss Bitcoin with you this morning.
I don't have any apps on my phone, so even using a remote control is a challenge for me. So we're going to talk about cryptocurrency and one particular form of cryptocurrency that's been in the news a lot, especially this year. That's Bitcoin. We'll start by defining cryptocurrency. Then we'll go into the details about Bitcoin. We'll share with you how you can acquire Bitcoins. And then we're going to analyze it as an investment. We're an investment consulting firm. You're our clients. This is our symposium. It's our job to have that conversation with you this morning. And we'll wrap up with some thoughts around the future and try to answer the question, as we look out into the future, will the majority of transactions be denominated in a cryptocurrency or in US dollars? What is cryptocurrency? It's a digital currency. It derives its name because it uses encryption techniques to regulate the generation of units of currency and to verify the transfer of funds. Critically, for any cryptocurrency, it is decentralized. There is no central bank which can influence the supply or value of cryptocurrency. There are many examples of cryptocurrency. It might be shocking to know that there are actually more than 900 types of cryptocurrency. Without a doubt, Bitcoin is the most well-known. It's covered in the media most frequently. Brian made the comment earlier, you can't pick up a Wall Street Journal or turn on CNBC and not hear something about Bitcoin. But there are a lot of other types as well. A few examples are pictured here, Ethereum, Litecoin, and Zcash are but just a few. I think it's instructive to contrast a transaction that takes place in traditional currency versus a transaction that takes place in cryptocurrency to understand how the two differ. Now, for any type of virtual transaction that we make today online, so if we were to buy something from Amazon, for example, there's a clearinghouse or a middleman which processes that transaction, transfers the funds, and collects some fees for taking care of the transaction. That's traditional currency as we know it today. Cryptocurrency is person to person. There's no middleman. There's some fees which tend to vary by the size of the transaction as well as the requested speed of that transaction. Critically though, every transaction is recorded on something called a blockchain. Now, blockchains can get really technical really fast. I don't think any of us are here to learn about computer programming this morning, so we're going to try to keep it relatively high level. Let's start by saying, and this is without a doubt the true of every cryptocurrency, that the blockchain is the foundation for all cryptocurrencies. A blockchain is a digital ledger in which all transactions are recorded chronologically and publicly. It looks something like the bottom half of this slide here, a bunch of computer code. But what this does is it can preserve the integrity of all transactions because everything is recorded in time. So transactions as well as new supply of Bitcoin that comes on the system or new supply of any cryptocurrency that comes on that particular platform. Schematically, it's a building block approach. Each subsequent block of transactions is based upon the prior blocks. It's impossible to alter previous records. If you wanted to, let's say, just as the picture illustrates here, you're a nefarious user of a cryptocurrency. And what you want to do is you want to break into the system and alter a previous block of transactions to try to steer some more of that cryptocurrency towards your account. It's impossible to do it for the following reason. The entire ledger of cryptocurrency, and we're going to talk about Bitcoin here, is 100,000 lines of code. A good programmer can get about 100 lines of code done in a day. And oh, by the way, this updates every 10 minutes. So this global network of programmers and the sheer size and speed of cryptocurrency networks makes it impossible to alter previous transactions. Well, we're here to talk about Bitcoin. So let's get into some of the details about Bitcoin. It was founded in 2009. It is not yet 9 years old. Over that 9 years, the value of one Bitcoin, the growth has been staggering, as has the volatility. And we're going to circle back to those items in just a couple minutes when we start to talk about Bitcoin as a potential investment. There are about 3 to 6 million users worldwide, 300,000 daily transactions. And it's worth repeating that blockchain ledger, it is a sophisticated technology. It ensures the integrity of all transactions and controls the new supply of Bitcoin. Two primary uses of Bitcoin. Number one, medium of exchange. You can buy things with it. By no means is it mainstream, but more and more retailers are accepting it as a form of payment. There are a few names up here, some of them may be familiar to you. The second use of Bitcoin, preservation of value. If you live in a country in which your currency is rapidly falling in value, perhaps because your country has defaulted on some debt, Bitcoin may be a better way to preserve your wealth. Does anyone recognize the city right here? Shout it out. Buenos Aires, Argentina. Correct. Buenos Aires, Argentina. Argentina's had a number of debt challenges, highlighted by a debt default in 2001. So residents who live in Argentina may find it more practical to preserve their wealth in Bitcoin. For the record, we are not recommending that, but we're just saying that some advocates of Bitcoin suggest that's a use. And some have gone as far as to suggest that Bitcoin is the new gold. After all, there's no central bank which could influence the behavior of Bitcoin, and there's a limited supply. Again, for reasons we're going to get into in the next section, we're not ready to recommend Bitcoin as a preservation of value, and certainly not the next new form of gold. Nonetheless, you might want to ask the question that, well, boy, how can I acquire some Bitcoin? I keep hearing about how good the returns are. How can I get my hands on Bitcoin? Well, the first method is just like anything else you want to buy today. Go onto the internet, find a virtual exchange, and you can buy Bitcoin. You can buy all the Bitcoin you want. Now, I'll caution you, Bitcoin's not cheap. One Bitcoin trades for about $4,100, but you can buy fractions on one Bitcoin. So it's possible to get into the game without $4,000. Now, the other method, and this method's free, that's the good news, is something called mining. You can use your computer to solve complex math problems. And boy, is the math behind this mining game awfully attractive. So a new problem is released about every 10 minutes. So all the players on the Bitcoin network try to solve this problem. And the first successful party or player to solve the problem is rewarded 25 Bitcoins. I just said that one Bitcoin costs about $4,000. 100,000 bucks in 10 minutes, that's a pretty good payday. That's an awfully good hourly rate. I think all of us would sign up for that. Perhaps also not surprising though, that payday has attracted a lot of players to the market. There is intense competition to successfully mine new Bitcoins. But these players aren't you or I going to Starbucks with our laptops to mess around for a couple hours and solve a couple of algebra problems. Rather, it's a competition between supercomputer centers like this. So unless you have the money, and I'm not kidding, to rent an airplane hangar, fill it with supercomputers and programmers to man all those supercomputers, you're better off sticking to a virtual exchange and just picking up a couple of Bitcoins when you feel like it. Let's pause for a minute here. I want to put some benchmarks around the size of Bitcoin because you hear about it in the news so much. Well, how big is Bitcoin really? We're going to compare it to two different data points. Number one, we're going to compare it to PayPal. Okay, now PayPal isn't trying to be its own form of currency, but PayPal in some ways serves the same purpose. It's a person-to-person transaction service. Now, the total capitalization of Bitcoin, and this fluctuates daily given the extreme volatility, but when these slides are put together, the total capitalization of Bitcoin was $71 billion. PayPal, $75 billion. So Bitcoin, for as much as you hear about it, still not the same size as PayPal. I think the next graph is even more powerful. We talked about trying to answer the question, are future transactions going to be based in dollars or Bitcoin? Well, there's $1.5 trillion in today's economy. $71 billion of Bitcoin. So Bitcoin, for all you hear about it, less than 5% of all US dollars. So at least for the foreseeable future, transactions will be based in dollars. Let's get to the return in investment story for Bitcoin. After all, we're here to help you make recommendations. And this has come up multiple times at clients. Honestly, we wouldn't be talking about it if our clients weren't asking about it. So when we look at investments for all of our clients, there are two primary data points we look at, right? Return and risk, and you can't look at either one of them independently. You have to look at them in conjunction with each other. And of course, the basic intuition, right? Investing 101, the first thing you learn, to get more return, you have to take risk. And boy, does Bitcoin satisfy both of those criteria. Okay, growth. So what we charted here is the value of one Bitcoin from January 2010 through the middle of September 2017. January 1st, 2013, you could buy one Bitcoin for $13.30. September 12th, 2017, that same Bitcoin cost you $4,128, okay? 31,000% growth in less than 5 years. Impressive? Yes. Staggering? Yes. Frightening? That too, yep. As I researched Bitcoin and read a lot of stories about Bitcoin, you ran across stories of a college kid who'd gotten 20 bucks mailed to him from his grandmother, and he said, well, I got nothing better to do with this. I'm gonna just go buy a couple Bitcoins. Say, you know, cost a buck, cost less than a buck. That kid today is a multimillionaire. 2017 in particular has been newsworthy for Bitcoin. It's grown from about $1,000 to almost $5,000 in early September. Then, after comments from the CEO of JP Morgan, along with some rumored regulation coming from India and China, dropped 25% in 2 days. We're gonna revisit the volatility story in just a minute, but Bitcoin has grown a lot this year. So why so much in 2017? This comes down to economics 101, demand versus supply. There's a lot more interest in Bitcoin these days. More retailers accept it. There's more geopolitical uncertainty. So for those countries whose currency is falling in value, you've seen some transfer of assets into Bitcoin. And then, most importantly, we've mentioned a couple times now, you can't pick up a Wall Street Journal. You can't turn on CNBC and not hear someone going on and on about Bitcoin. There's more interest. More people are getting into the mining game. People want to have Bitcoins. Demand greater than supply, what happens? Price goes up. So the old volatility issue. Let's circle back to that. What you see here on this chart is the index level of the S&P 500 and the dollar value of one Bitcoin, again, over a long period of time. And there are a couple points to take away. I don't think anyone in this room would suggest that equities are conservative. In fact, I think all of us can agree that equities tend to be the most risky asset class in an institutional portfolio. The annual volatility of S&P 500 stocks over this time period has been 11%. The annual volatility of Bitcoin over that same time period, 240%. You see a lot of monthly drops. I already mentioned this month alone, we saw a 25% drop peak to trough of Bitcoin. Maybe this is just the next bubble. What we've done here is charted the run-up of tech stocks and biotech stocks. And that axis is on the right-hand side. We're talking hundreds of percent, okay? 300%, 500%. Impressive growth. I think any of us would take that all day long. Then we compare that with Bitcoin, 31,000% growth, okay? So you thought the tech sector was sector run-up was significant? Well, compared to Bitcoin. Now, we're not suggesting that Bitcoin is on the precipice of correcting, but I feel pretty good about that. If we revisit Bitcoin price 5 years from now at another symposium, it won't be up 31,000% still. So as we set out to answer the question, is Bitcoin an institutional asset class? I think you've probably already made your own conclusions about that. But what we want to do here is revisit the volatility issue. I mentioned Bitcoin is not yet 9 years old. And it has had five bear markets of 60% or more in that time period. Compare that to equities, which again are far from a safe investment. Equities have had one since correction of that magnitude in almost 100 years worth of data. So if nothing else, this should crystallize the notion that Bitcoin is volatile. And quite simply, it's not an institutional asset class. If any of you, our consultants come to you and recommend Bitcoin as a potential asset class, can you please give Brian a call? Because we're going to have the consultant fired because he's not going to work at Marquette anymore, okay? It's simply not an institutional asset class. Too volatile, it's too young, the overall capitalization is too small. Perhaps more important than any of those reasons, the SEC has deemed it not an appropriate asset class. There have been multiple attempts to formulate ETFs based upon Bitcoin value. SEC has consistently cited cybersecurity concerns, as well as the fact it is an unregulated market. One other historical comparison I ran into over time, ran into as I researched Bitcoin, was it was compared to tulip mania. Now, does anyone recall what tulip mania is? Okay, so there are a couple hands. If you don't remember, that's okay, because we have to go back 400 years to look at this data. But in the mid-1630s, tulips first started showing up in Europe and quickly became a status symbol. This brilliant color, never before seen type of flower. The richest of the rich had to have them. Well, it's a hot item, right? So you're gonna get speculators entering the market, trying to make a few bucks off it. Prices went up and up and up, peaked in late 1636. Guess what happened in early 1637? Off a cliff, completely fell apart, the trade disappeared. In fact, there are some people, such as the CEO of JP Morgan, who thinks that the end of Bitcoin is gonna be worse. I quote, "It's worse than tulip bulbs, it won't end well. Someone is going to get killed. Currencies have legal support, it will blow up." This is right around the same time you started to hear about rumored regulations from India and China, and then perhaps not shockingly, the head of global derivatives at the same bank, JP Morgan, came out and made similar disparaging remarks. That explains why Bitcoin dropped 25% in 2 days. It's young, it's volatile, much is unknown about price behavior of Bitcoin. But we can't completely dismiss Bitcoin at this point in time. Certainly, there are challenges as we sit here today. The software is complex. It's difficult to understand. You really don't know what Bitcoin's being used for. You can track transactions, but you don't know what those transactions were for. So maybe it's used to launder money. Maybe it's used to buy drugs. Who knows? And country regulation, I think, is really the 800-pound gorilla as it relates to the future of Bitcoin and if it's going to become a dominant form of payment. But let's be honest. Not every form of technological innovation catches on right away. It certainly wasn't common, and it was actually highly impractical for many people to use the internet in the late 80s or early 90s. Today, it is a way of life, clearly a game changer. Here are some common applications we all know, and for all I know, some of you are using these right now as I speak. Don't worry, feelings aren't hurt. I understand it's been a long day so far. It's also worth making the point that for every technological innovation that catches on, some don't. 3D TVs, Google Glasses. I'm not going to name names of Marquette employees, but there are multiple consultants who ran out and bought a 3D TV as soon as it came to market. They could not stop talking about how great it was in the lunchroom after they bought it. And I asked a couple of them the other day, where are those glasses that you had to use for the 3D TVs? They don't know where they are. TVs are long gone. And then, to have a little bit of fun with it, one of our analysts spent the better part of a year walking around the office in Google glasses, but we haven't seen those on them recently either. So the point is, not every form of technology catches hold. Let's wrap up. I mentioned it a couple times. It's still early for Bitcoin. At this point, not an institutional asset class, not a store of value, and it's not user-friendly. It's not yet 9 years old. Much is unknown about supply, demand, and price dynamics. We wanted to answer the question, as we look out into the future, do we think the majority of transactions will be based in dollars or cryptocurrency? I think the answer is pretty straightforward. It's dollars.